Hey, what's up, everybody? My name is Trophinet, and welcome to the very last episode of The Witcher 3 on the Deathmatch difficulty. It's been a long time coming. We're still in, we're back in Beauclair. I'm gonna spend my last episode here, and today we're gonna just kick back and relax a bit. But first, I, of course, wanna thank you all for the support during this, well, it has been quite a journey. It's been a big part of my life for the last year. I've been making an episode every 2 days for over a year now. And it's been one hell of a journey. And couldn't have done it without you guys' support. Especially because The Witcher is one of the most watched series on my channel. Not that many people watch it, but still appreciate the support, guys. Really, really, really do. But today we're gonna do a little bit, something a little bit different. I'm gonna just explore a bit and talk about what we've done, what we've been through. I'm gonna show you a few ways to play this game. We're gonna make a few builds and we're gonna explore Toussaint with those builds for a bit. So first off, I'm gonna buy a potion of clearance from the alchemist here in town. And I mean, Beauclair is the perfect place to do this because look at this city. We've never really, well, I kind of appreciate it sometimes, but this is very well done. Blood and Wine is just amazingly done. Not that the rest of the game isn't, but it's such a big difference with the rest of the game that it really, really shines. Hello, Herbalist.
A returning customer is a satisfied customer. Come, peruse and buy.
Indeed, a returning customer is a satisfied customer. So yeah, I'm gonna have a look.
Let me see what you got.
Because I think she sells, or she... Yeah, she does. Kinda panicking over there, because usually they only sell one of those potion of clearances. Potions of clearance? Yeah, that will be the multiple of that. So let's buy that. 1,000 crowns for a potion of clearance. You know what? Just gonna buy 5. So we can reset a few times this episode, and we don't really need the money anymore, so there we go. Thank you.
So long.
This is also one of the Gwent players, by the way, that you need to defeat to complete the Skellige deck. So, first up, I want to make something I've never really dabbled with, but I'm going to make a build focused on alchemy. So, especially since we found the Manticore set, in the, not the previous episode, but the episode before that, that's a perfect opportunity to show you what a build focused on alchemy would look like. So give me a second. You know what? Fuck it. Since this is the last episode, I'm just gonna walk to Corvo Bianco. No fast traveling. We're gonna enjoy this lovely, lovely town. So I'm gonna head to Corvo Bianco and we're gonna pick up the Manticore set again. We're gonna wear that for the next 10-15 minutes probably. But yeah, look at that view. I mean, come on. Because yeah, in case you're wondering, I kind of completely cleared everything in the game that I could, I think. Because if you check out my quest log, I'm going to show you in a second. So the only secondary quest I still have available is our Knight for Hire, which is completing some minor contracts on the map, on the Toussaint map. And Collect Them All is completing the collection of Gwent cards, which, by the way, I can never get in this run, mainly because the main characters actually disappear from the game when you complete the main game. So that kind of sucks. So that means I can't beat Zoltan anymore, can't beat Dandelion anymore, and can't beat Taller anymore for their cards. Although I got the cards of everybody, and Vernon Ronge, by the way, and I got the cards of everybody who died, I can't get those cards from a few guys that are still alive, so that kind of sucks, but never mind. And then the treasure hunts, the only one available is the Grandmaster Ursine gear, which I said before is bugged because every subtask is complete, but it didn't disappear from my my quest log. But never mind that, we're already a quarter of the way there. Let's head to through the tourney grounds, because that's actually where the first few hours of Blood and Wine are situated, so that's... It's a very interesting area as well. It's also weird, kind of never explained. So if anybody can explain that to me in the comment section, that giant smoke plume, I've mentioned it a few times in a few episodes, because you can see it from Corvo Bianco as well. and
dare to think you've got
there's a giant
here.
Pile of corpses just burning in the center of the arena over there. I'm going to check it out. Passing by the crossbow task competition.
Geralt, are you
from the tourney? But yeah, in here, in the... Do I need to enter from... Yeah, over here. In here? Can I actually... No. I'm gonna have to take the higher route. There's actually a pile of corpses. I wonder... Is it closed? I don't actually know. I thought this stayed open for a while, because I clearly remember going through here with Roach. But yeah, you can see it from over here. There's a giant pile of burning corpses over there. Don't really know what that's all about, because we never really saw anybody die in the tourney. So maybe a few of the other matches against other monsters that killed people? I don't know. Kind of weird. So if anybody can explain that to me, please do in the comments. It's also funny, you can hear the peacocks making a noise, and it's actually... Now, because I'm playing Final Fantasy XV at the moment as well, and they use the same sound effect for chocobos than The Witcher does for peacocks, which is interesting. So chocobos make the noise that peacocks make. And there we go, Corvo Bianco. I'm gonna have to take... Okay, did she just talk to me like, hey kitty kitty, meow? That was weird. I'm gonna take the manticore gear. So let's take all... that. Thank you. Oh, no. What? Take all. Thank you. There are manticore swords, but I think I kept those in the chest. Which is also very interesting to watch, by the way. The chest, whatever I have in there. Because there's a lot of stuff in there. So mainly the Viper stuff. And then, of course, the Mastercrafted Wolven gear, because I made the Grandmaster without the Mastercrafted set. So let's get the Manticore Silver Sword. And then I want the Venomous Viper Swords, if I'm not mistaken. Manticore Steel Swords, I take that. So most of these are weapons from bosses, like the Shovel from the Caretaker. The Caretaker's Spade. So 10% of damage dealt returned as Vitality healing you. It's actually really... really interesting effect, certainly for that much. But yeah, now we have all geared sword, Iris, which charges with energies kind of like Arendite, but the strong attack then releases that energy in an extra powerful strike at the cost of a part of the attacker's vitality. So we lose health if we attack with that. And then Blave is the sword that we got from the Ofiri contender in the Gwent tournament. And then the Ofiri armor, of course, the armor we wore, the stuff we wore when we were possessed by Olgierd's brother. I kind of forgot his name. That is horrible. Then the armor during the tournament. Viper gear that I made. And then, oh, my golden boots. It's funny how high they are up in this list. And then the Necker hide boots we got from the Skellige's Most Wanted quest, I think, where the monsters... were pissed at me because of what I did before. And then parts of the Tesha Mutna gear. I never found that completely, if I'm not mistaken. I think I'm still missing the armor itself. Because I have everything else. The crossbows. Kind of sad that that never got a buff. Because it stays at 10 and 12. Even with the specific Witcher gear crossbows. I don't know. I think I accidentally made a second feline crossbow. And then all the trophies of the monsters we've killed. That's just so nice to look at right now. But yeah, I think that's what I need from the chest. I'm going to actually sleep here as well for a second. Because that gives me the bonuses I need for the alchemy skill build. So yeah, Geralt, sit down. Thank you. And just sleep until noon, maybe. There we go. We get those bonuses now. Was that? Yeah, that was long enough. By the way, I never actually showed that, I think. You can actually use this bookshelf in the bedroom to store all the books you have. And it just makes a copy of that. So even if you lose the book, you can actually just still read it from over there. Next up, I'd like to take the feline armor. Thank you. And then all the griffin armor. I'm going to quickly check. I have plenty of space left. So, and then I'm gonna need the Griffin swords as well. Is this? Yeah, Griffin silver sword, Griffin steel sword, and I think, I'm not really sure. This is the feline gear. And I'm gonna take that as well. So, now we're pretty much clear. I'm just gonna respec everything right here and put on the right clothes. So there we go, the complete Manticore set added. It's mainly because the armor piercing is really, really good. That's something that's a given. And then critical hit damage and chance is also very important in an alchemy build, especially with the fact that critical hit chance and damage are also applied to bombs, which increases that enormously. Also, poison is partly based on your critical hit chance. So a critical hit has more chance to poison someone than it does any other hit. So the armor piercing is both on the silver and the steel sword, which is good. And then, of course, the extra toxicity you get from the entire set, which adds 30 extra toxicity from the armor set and adds a bit of critical bonuses as well. So really good all the way. Then Luke, let's use the Potion of Clearance to return all my ability points. There we go. So there we go, everything empty. That's how it looks like. So we have 64 ability points left to spend. So let's do that really quickly. Give me a second. So this is actually interesting. I got my ability points back, but the mutations didn't go back. So I didn't lose the mutations I already activated, which is interesting. So that means if you just buy a few potions of clearance, you get all your mutations possibly. Not that you can activate more than one, but yeah, interesting. So I'm going to go for the last one in the alchemy tree here, because the other ones are less interesting. Aside from this one, metamorphosis, but I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do that just yet. So I'm going to go with mutated skin. Each adrenaline point decreases damage received by 15%. I'm going to show you in a second why. It's actually really important for the build. So here we go. This is the skill tree I'm using for the alchemy build. Very, very dangerous build to use on that much, but with a lot of things that get back to you as well. So first up, pyrotechnics. All bombs, even those that usually do not inflict damage, now deal 150 damage in addition to their normal effects. And then acquired tolerance. Every known level 1, 2, or 3 alchemy formula increases maximum toxicity by 1, allowing you to drink more potions. Time is slowed 45% while aiming bombs. Just gonna use a lot of bombs, mainly because of this ability, cluster bombs. Upon detonation, bombs separate into explosive fragments. Number of fragments is 6. So that's the maximum level you could get. Synergy is really, really good, because it increases the bonus for mutagen placed in mutagen slot by 50%. So that allows us to boost our health to a whopping... I'm going to have to check that out, what the total is right now. But it increases everything very, 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 very high. Mainly because of all the skills I've chosen, which makes your survivability a lot higher. Which is, of course, good on that march. Hunter instinct, when adrenaline points are at their maximum, critical hit damage against the targeted enemy type is increased by 100%. It's double critical hit damage, basically, if you use the right poison, oil. And side effect, imbibing a potion gives a 100% chance of activating the effects of an elder randomly selected potion without additional toxicity cost, which is really, really good. Refreshment, each potion dose imbibed heals 25% of maximum vitality, which is also adding towards the survivability on that march. And then just for having the extra attack, 25% extra fast attack damage, just because. And then efficiency increases the maximum number of bombs in each slot by 5, which is going to help us out really, really good. And then poison blades, of course. Oil applied to blades gives a 15% chance of poisoning the target on each hit. Chance is greater the higher the level of oil used. And then protective coating adds 25% protection against attacks from the monster type the oil targets. So if you're using the correct oils, we get 25% protection from protective coating and then a whopping 45 if our adrenaline points are up because of mutated skin. So that should technically make us a survivability beast. I'm just quickly gonna check the stats screen. But that should technically, yeah, look at that. 10,100, that's over double the vitality I had before. Just because of the perks and a 297 toxicity. The only thing we don't have now, which is important to note, is that we don't really have a strong Quen sign right now. So we're going to have to rely a lot less on Quen. Just going to quickly go in here and check out this thing, because if I activate that, okay, can't I? Oh no, that's just activated because of the, or is that over here? Yeah, that's over here. So I get extra items from this as well. So that should give us a lot of extra charges. I'm quickly going to check in the menus. So adding the effect of the bed in Corvo Bianco and the alchemy station, we're getting 7 charges out of each potion, and along with the perk for bombs, we get 11 freaking bombs. That is so awesome, I can't even tell you how awesome that is. I'm also going to swap that back out for Grape Shot, I think. Although Northern Wind, I never use Northern Wind, but you know what, just to try it out. So fire and an ice bomb. Now let's find us some enemies. So on our way to a vineyard infestation. Yeah, kind of feel sad that this is the last episode. I'm going to make it into one hell of an episode, because this is only the first build. I'm going to try and make 3 if I have the time. Should have the time if I'm looking at the clock right now. But yeah, I really enjoyed this game. I mean, I wouldn't have spent over a year in this game if I wouldn't have enjoyed it and kept making these videos. And it felt all the better if you guys made a nice comment about it and told me that you enjoyed watching it, because yeah, it's quite a lot of work. And now we have centipedes. So let's, I'm gonna quickly just use, of course, insectoid oil. Look at that, that was a hit from a 38. Wow. From a 38 centipede, and we didn't really care. So let's go with the dancing star. Look at that, those bombs are amazing. These bombs are really cool. Should have to be careful not to set myself on fire there. But let's start hitting them. Okay. Look, wow. The effect of the potions are amazing, and Gordon Oriole has been added as well. That is wow. So survivability, very high. I mean, he's hitting me and I don't care. And I don't even have the, wow. And look how long Swallow lasts. What now? Look how long it lasts. I'm just healing indefinitely. And I can do that 7 times without even meditating. That's the critical hit damage piling up. I'm getting hit by things that would have killed me in 2 hits in my other build. And this is just amazing. Look at that. I don't care. I mean, these guys can hit me all day long. I don't care. But look, those are poisoned hits, and I'm not taking any damage. What? That is, and I mean, I heal automatically every time I use a potion. So if I use something stupid like for example, Killer Whale. Where's my health? My health is over there on the bottom right. If I use that, yep, healed up. Wow. I mean, this is only viable later in the game, of course, because you can't get all those skills immediately, but wow. I mean, look at that. I imbibed Killer Whale and Swallow automatically activated as well. This is just amazing. And that's just one of the builds you can do. And this is something completely different than I used. There's also a skill, an ability that eventually doubles the amount of charges your oils have. But if you have the later oils, I don't think it's really necessary. If you keep an eye on it, it's just a waste of free ability points that you can put somewhere else. Because yeah, oils are free anyway. So that was something cool. I mean, this build is really, really strong. So Manticore gear, and then the perks I just mentioned, and that should give you just use a few oils, etc., and potions and bombs. I mean, bombs. Have you seen what those bombs do? The damage wasn't incredible. I know that, but I mean, look at what it does. I mean, I throw one and it's like I called in a freaking airstrike. So that's the effect of the cluster bomb, and it just blankets the entire area with fire. I mean, goodbye, Beauclair. Toussaint. That is amazing. But I'm gonna head back. No, I'm actually not gonna head back. I can do that right here. I brought everything back with me that I wanted to, so let's head into the combat tree right now. So I'm gonna imbibe another potion of clearance, and then we're gonna make a hell of a combat Geralt. Just one big powerhouse, so give me a second. So for combat armor, I'm gonna go with, you can see I lost all my perks that added other charges, because I only have 5 potion charges and 4 bombs anymore. But the feline steel sword, mainly because of the critical hit chance and the bleeding. Bleeding is the most important bit there. And then Arendite. You could, of course, go for the silver sword, the feline silver sword, but it doesn't give any great benefits. Arendite boosts the damage by each blow. So each blow generates charges which increase the sword damage by 10%. And a fully charged sword just does double damage, which is great as a start. But killing, I think, a fully charged sword always deals critical hit damage. And what we're going to do with this build is just boost critical hit damage through the roof. You partly saw that already with my build that I used at the later episodes. Because before that, I kind of used a hybrid build between combat and science. But this will be fully, fully combat. And then, of course, the entire feline set, just because of the attack power boost. So that just boosts it up to 66%. Just a blanket 66% attack boost. As mutation, I'm going to go for Bloodbath. Each fatal blow dealt by a sword dismembers the enemy or activates a finisher. Each blow dealt by a weapon in melee combat increases attack power by 5% until combat ends to a maximum of 250%. The bonus is lost if you take damage, not including damage from toxicity. So we're going to try and mitigate that as much as we can. So there we go. So again, the potion of clearance doesn't clear your mutations for some reason. Although, so that's what it does. So you don't get your ability points back from mutation. So that's the reason why, because now I have less points available than I had before. So yeah, that's a bit of an issue, but here we go. So there we go, a blood red skill tree. So basically muscle memory and of course strength training increases fast attack damage by 25% and strong attack damage by 25%. Precise blows, and I think I took, didn't I take the critical hit chance for the heavy strikes as well? I think I did. But critical hit chance increased by 10% for fast attacks and damage increased by 75%. Fleet-footed, of course, becoming immune for damage while dodging. Whirl, a spinning attack that strikes all foes in the surrounding area. Maintaining the attack consumes stamina and adrenaline. And then we have arrow deflection, just 1 point, just so I can safely deflect arrows. Counterattack. After a successful counterattack, the next attack deals 30% damage per skill level and is a critical hit with a chance for knockdown based on the number of adrenaline points. So that's 90% extra damage because we have 3 skill points in that. Deadly precision. Each adrenaline point adds 2% to the chance of killing an opponent instantly. This effect cannot be triggered more than once every 15 seconds. Sunder armor reduces enemy damage resistance by 25%. And then the cat school techniques. Each piece of light armor increases critical hit damage by 25%, so that's another 100% extra critical hit damage, and fast attack damage by 5%, 25% added. And then attack is the best defense. Each defensive action generates adrenaline points. Parries 0.1, counterattack 0.4, dodge 0.3, roll 0.2, and cannot be activated more than once every 5 seconds. And then Rend deals additional damage in proportion to the stamina consumed, ignores enemy defense, and increases critical hit chance by 50%. And then at random points increase total damage by 33%. And then we have a total of 140% attack power because of the mutagens, which would make this guy a powerhouse. We also have crushing blows, increase strong attack critical chance by 10% and critical damage by 75%. And then crippling strikes, fast attacks now also apply a bleeding effect, that enemies lose 125 vitality or essence points per seconds, and it takes 5 seconds to wear off. This is a monster. I'm gonna find me some monsters and just kill them immediately. Never actually destroyed the nest, by the way, so let's do that right now. Kabushki! Let's take all that. Not that I really need it, although I could have used those greater mutagens. But let's go find ourselves some trouble. I might want to talk about what we're gonna do after The Witcher, because, well, I'm not gonna stop my channel because The Witcher is done, of course. But for the next few weeks, I'm gonna probably just continue the Bioshock series and the XCOM series. And ooh, I think there's a quest over there. And when it releases, I'm gonna start a playthrough of Horizon Zero Dawn. So that might be our next RPGs. Hello, wine merchant.
Heard you calling. Wanted to talk?
I did, for we're neck deep in trouble of the spider kind.
Need a Leave that to broom, me. Not a witcher.
You fail to understand. These are huge. The size of pigs or dogs. Black and hairy, spewing webs.
Mm-hmm. Not talking about spiders then. Talking about arachnomorphs.
Call arachnomorphs.
You must smash the rogues, will you? Those caves would be prime barrel storage were it not for the beasts.
So this is one of those Knight for Hire quests. I'm just going to quickly talk about my
first
pay.
First things first. Need to talk about my reward.
Not that that really matters at this point, but so yeah, Horizon Zero Dawn will be our next game that we're going to play. I also have a surprise for next week. We're going to start up group therapy again. We're going to have a few of those episodes every week in some horror game. You might have known about it already. You might have heard about it already. But without spoiling too much.
I knew we would agree terms.
I usually agree on 180 coins, so I can take care of that for you.
Arachnomorphs don't look much like bunnies, but they sure breed like them. Best nip the problem in the bud. I'll look into it.
Okay, so that's a prime opportunity for us to just murder stuff. Let's check out the cave. There must be a lot of spiders in this place. Hello? Anybody here? I'm not going to loot anything. Let's use Gwen either way, and now let's see. And slash, slash, slash. Oh, look at that. These guys usually are a lot stronger. Holy shit. That guy didn't stand a chance. I'm actually wondering how you perform that whirly-whirl attack. Oh, look at that. That was a giant arachnomorph down in 3 hits. Hello! Oh, the other problem will be... Oh, shit, yeah, okay. Survivability is another problem. Oh, that was a slowing time. And that was the cave. So yeah, all that combined is... Wow. It's a very powerful build. If you're just focusing on attack power, this is the way to go. Of course, very dangerous on that march because you don't have any defense. Because the alchemy build was a lot better suited actually for that march because you heal by a lot of things. But yeah, general attack power, this is really, really great. I want to check out the stat screen, by the way. So there we go. So fast attack critical... Why is that so low? 15%, so that's just because of the gear, probably. So it doesn't take into account what we have for skills, which is kind of stupid, but... Because it just adds everything that we have. Because it only... Yeah, it doesn't really take into account what we actually can do, because some things can actually stack up really, really nicely. Where is this guy? Oh, that's the guy. He's right in front of the cave. Never mind.
Any tidings?
Any tidings? Well, it's taken care of.
And cleaned up.
Thank the gods. And you too, of course.
Thank you. It's amazing that you that you're willing to trust a guy in a hoodie like that. Because Geralt looks a bit shady in that outfit. Let's see. How do I actually... I want to check that out. How do I use... Ah, there's the whirl attack. That is it. Okay, I want to try that out on an enemy, by the way. So remember, if you're using the Grandmaster gear, the Grandmaster Cat School gear, that if you use a heavy attack first for the next 5 seconds, your fast attacks do double damage, which is amazing. But yeah, let's go find ourselves some enemies. I think, yeah, I put a marker down already, but we passed that quest. So let's head over there. So yeah, next up for the channel, mentioned this before, but I'm going to do it again. Aside from Bioshock, which is going to continue until we completed everything. So we're going to complete Bioshock 2 probably pretty soon. And then we're going to do the DLC, Minerva's Den. Then Bioshock Infinite, and then all the DLC of Bioshock Infinite. So Burial at Sea, Episode 1 and 2. So that should fill that nicely. XCOM 2 is still going in full strength as well. If you wanna add a character to the character pool, you can still do that, of course. So don't forget to head over there and add a character. So you can see yourself in XCOM as a valorous soldier. And then when it comes out at the beginning of March and the February, we're going to start playing Horizon Zero Dawn, and next week we're going to start group therapy in a horror game as well. So let's try this. Oh shit, this is not good, this is not good, this is not good, this is not good. This is not good. Wolves. Hello. Come here! Oh, I don't even see their health bar anymore. They just get swiped away. That is interesting, but I think it works better on bandits, if I'm not mistaken. Let's just quickly head over there. I wonder what there is. God, I'm not gonna go too long with this build. You might want to add some Quen abilities to this, because it's pretty much a glass cannon in this light armor. Even though it is Grandmaster, so it should be the same armor rating than anything else. What is this? It looks... A rabbit truck roll. Yeah. A rabbit truck roll. He's running away for some reason. There we go. And then let's just go haywire on him. Ooh, that kind of killed them all. Oh, hi. Oh, shit. So that's what I'm talking about. This guy is a glass cannon. Oh wow! Whoa. I'm not gonna die. There we go. Whew. Yeah, very much a glass cannon. I'm not used to playing this like this. Of course, I usually have the protection of Quen, or of course the. What's this? Guarded treasure, a rag scrap with writing on it. On this scrap ran from my own garment, using my own blood and a fragment of bone from some unknown creature, I write a summary of my sad tale. For I shall surely perish forthwith. Perhaps one day a bard shall happen upon it and compose from it a ballad to squeeze tears from the most pitiless miser. Some time ago I spied a monster roaming in proximity to my estate. Upon further investigation I learned it was a she-troll, descended from the Gorgon foothills. I just scraped together a few crowns and went to the Camerlengo to request he hire a knight-errant to slay the monstrosity. Yet as I was making this journey, said she-troll sprang out of the bushes, knelt down by my horse and professed something in the garbled speech of trolls that I took to mean she had chosen me as her beau. Since it is most ill-bred to be rude to a lady, even a monstrous one, I declined her politely and was ready to be on my way when she tossed a sack over me, tucked me under her arm, and carried me here to this clearing. She locked me in a cage and stared at me for hours, sending creeping shivers down my spine. So now I slowly starve to death, for while she gives me clear water to drink, my only food is a soup that she-troll spends all day brewing. A foul concoction reeking of carrion and onion. I would rather perish than put that slurry to my lips. So, that's interesting. So, this guy was kidnapped by the she-troll, because she was attracted to him. And then she let him die because he didn't want to eat her soup, the brew here. Is it so bad? Doesn't look that bad. But that's the combat build. Now we're going to make the last, ability tree. I'm going to use that and just make a sign build, so a magic build. So here we go. So of course, if we're going signs, we're going the Griffin school gear. So 21 on the steel sword, 21 on the silver sword, and then 22 on the armor, 11. So 66 in total on the... No, that's 11. It's 55 on the armor. 55 and 21 is a 76 bonus every time. And then the bonuses you get after using stamina to cast a sign in its standard mode, the next sign cast within 3 seconds will be cast in standard mode without using stamina. So you can combine Quen immediately with an Igni, for example, or an Urden or anything else. The size of Urden traps is increased by 40% while you are within an Urden trap. Stamina regeneration is increased by 5 per second and sign intensity by 100. And damage is reduced by 20%. So it pays off to use Quen oft and Urden in succession every time. Because that's, it's just going to help you out greatly. So the last decoction, potion of clearance has been imbibed. I'm not going to use any of those. Although, I could actually go for magic sensibility. So signs can deal critical hits. The critical hit chance and damage increase with sign intensity, currently 38% chance, to deal an additional 183. And opponents killed by critical hits from signs explode. Which is, it sounds amazing. So let's take that. So there we go, blue skill tree all the way. By the way, the signs skill tree is actually the most friendly towards your ability points usage, because most of them are only up to level 3 if you want to max them out, even one with level 2. But, of course, melt armor. Damage dealt by Igni also permanently weakens enemy armor. Effect scales with sign intensity up to a maximum of 75%. Sustained glyphs increases sign duration by 10 seconds. Number of alternate mode charges 9. And number of standard traps is 2. So you can place those all over the place. Delusion. Target does not move towards Geralt while he's casting Igni. Increases the effectiveness of Axie. It's always Axie. And dialogues reduces Axie casting time and failed Axie attempts stagger the target. Active shield, of course. Maintaining an active shield no longer drains stamina. Stamina drain for blocked attacks unchanged. Damage absorbed by the shield restores player vitality. Very good on that much, as you might have seen in this playthrough already. Magic trap damages and slows enemies within a 14-yard radius, which is increased by the Griffin gear. Destroys projectiles passing through this area. Damage increased by 50%. Igni intensity increased by 25%, and then the supercharged glyphs, of course, because we're going to be using those a lot. Enemies under the influence of Urden lose 50 points of vitality or essence per second. Quen intensity by 25% increased, and then Quen discharge reflects 25% of absorbed damage back to the attacker. In the center row, column, we have Puppet. Targeted enemy briefly becomes an ally and deals 60% more damage. Earn intensity increased by 25% and domination, which allows us to influence two opponents by Axie at the same time without any, negative side effects. Griffin's cool techniques. Each piece of medium armor increases sign intensity by 5% and stamina regeneration also by 5%. So that's 20 for each. And then rage management. If your current stamina level is too low, signs can be cast using adrenaline points. And poison blades, just to add a bit of poison if we use our oils correctly. Mainly because there aren't really any more sign abilities that I wanted to use. So that's pretty much it. So signs all the way. Very interesting build. Because now I should be able to use Quen and then immediately Urden. There we go. Saw that? I used two signs immediately after each other. And I mean, my stamina comes back really fast. But that's mainly because... Is that an extra effect? Oh, look at that. That's an extra effect added because of the armor, that purple haze around my body and the extra electrifying effect. That's really cool. Let's go find ourselves some enemies. I also think Quen takes a lot longer to go back. So now we're out of the Urden signs and we lost that effect. But we're pretty close to enemies. So I want to actually see how fast my stamina recharges and then when we're in combat. So that's guarded treasure. Wonder what it's guarded by. So let's use Quen. Oh, okay. So let's use an Urden sign. I don't even see the radius. How far does this reach? Because they're losing damage, of course. If I now use this, I can actually immediately cast that again. Oh, wow. So that's... And I can use side immediately. Look at that. How fast does that go back? That is like 2 seconds. And yeah, that was an explosion. Wow. Get wrecked. Why did I never specialize? And the urn sign is still active. Oh, there's a... I see part of the radius. I did spawn 2 of them, but... I mean, how long does this take? I think that was... No, we're still inside one of them. So this one, we're still inside this one. Holy shit, that takes a while. I'm gonna just quickly grab the treasure and then I'm gonna find some other enemies because this was ridiculous. Let's take all that. Codex of Lot Halfbreeds Hanze. I think I killed that guy already. We're chained dogs in rusted rags, forced to stare into the manners of the rich and rot with jealousy. We toil in their fields for a few pathetic crowns. We've not even got a great war, no great tragedies. Our great war is fought against ourselves. Our great tragedy is our banal existence. Our elders raised us to believe one day we will throw off our weighty burden. But that shall never happen. Slowly we have come to realize this, and that has us rip-roaring with rage. Lot's Hanze gives those who join something in return. It shows them that without pain, without sacrifice, the Hanze would achieve nothing. That by joining its ranks, they will get what they have always desired. But to grasp this, they must be ready to fight for their lives. Because when you come here for the first time, you must fight. So that's just, talking about why somebody would join a bandit group. Let's see on the map. I might want to find something else. Because this is amazing. Why did I never... Well, a lot of people say that the Griffin army is the ugliest set of the bunch. I don't agree with that. But, yeah, it's really, really useful, though. That was amazing. I mean, firing, firing, firing all the way. Not that this says anything, but in combat, it's only 2 seconds. I mean, I think this is where the Hanze is located. Didn't we kill that? Yeah, I think we killed the entire set over there. So, I've set my last waypoint. We're going to head over there, and then we'll... I'm wondering, what do you guys use for builds? Let me know in the comments what you guys used for a build, because there's actually a lot of options. I never actually realized this, because I usually go with a hybrid build, more skewed towards science, but not even as powerful as this one, because I used the Griffin armor in my original playthrough. But yeah, I did like the Wolven armor a bit more. That's why I used it during most of the playthrough. But the Griffin armor is so powerful. Being able to cast 2 signs in succession, and then just even a second later you can cast it again twice. So you can actually cast signs constantly, can't you? Okay. No. Yeah, okay. I mean, look at this. That's just ridiculous. I know it's outside of combat, but inside of combat it's not really that much different. Hello, bear. And an urn sign, and just fire away. I mean, this guy can't do anything. But just stand in front of a crowd, this will have the same effect. It just blasts igni in their faces constantly, and armor melts away. It's just a great way to stun them as well. So, why would I... I mean, I'm invincible. Because Quen is...
Something seriously wrong here.
Quen is so powerful that I can't even... die, and if they hit me, they're just gonna get... I mean, look at that! That was a charge from a Bargist, and they only got half my point sign. There we go, and they explode when they... I don't know why that is. Is that just a knockback? I'm not even using my sword. Although these guys seem to be pretty resilient to my signs, though. But, I mean... Also, it's even highlighted, so... When I use a... Oh, that was a thingy. So I don't really have much, of course, in the name of sword damage. But, I mean, look at this. I'm not even trying, because in the urn sign, the stamina recovery is amazing, so I'm just keeping them at bay with... Look at this! This is so ridiculous! And I can't even use my adrenaline points, because adrenaline points are now also created because of the... each time I use signs? Oh no, I don't. So I need to actually use my sword to get adrenaline points. Ooh, wow, that one exploded. I just don't need to stop using signs. This is... Even these guys, which have really high magic resistance, I could just blow them away. I'm casting one every second. I'm not even spending adrenaline points at this rate. Wow. Yeah, I mean, if you want to have my favorite, the alchemy was really cool. Because alchemy is always underrated. But if you set it up great, as I did in the first build of this episode, that's just a really, really amazing way to go around doing. Because you're practically invulnerable. Especially if you start using potions and the like. Because you get your health back so quickly. Because potions give them back 25% of your health back. Even it's percentage-based, so even if you have a huge amount of vitality, as I had, it just gives you back 25% of that. But this is amazing as well. Just keep casting every sign, and each sign is powered up to infinity. So I'm a monster. But yeah, it really pains me to say this, but... yeah, it really does, because this has been the last episode. I don't have anything left in the game. If you want me to do something else in The Witcher, let me know. But as far as I can tell, this is everything I could have done. As I set out, when I started the series, I wanted to show you guys pretty much everything. I missed the one quest I still... It really pains me that I never saw it, was the Cave of Dreams, because we did some of the contracts out of order. Accidentally, because it's not really marked, of course. So we missed that quest, which is a really cool one. But yeah, this is it for The Witcher. 195 episodes. It's a shame I don't get to a 200, but it would have been just a waste of time. Waste of my time, waste of your time. Just watching me go around and do some menial tasks. But we've done pretty much everything. All the fist fighting, all the horse races, all the Gwent tournaments. We've gathered all the sets. We've built that lovely statue over there. Look at these puppies. Puppies. I'm in a field of puppies. So yeah, I'm done with The Witcher. I don't even realize this myself, but wow, it's gonna take some adjusting to do, because I'm really used to making a Witcher video every 2 days. So yeah, of course, the most important thing, I'd like to thank you guys for all the support and watching. Especially if you watch the entire series, kudos to you. Because I know it's hard to watch an entire series, especially one that has 195 episodes. But really, a special thank you for everybody who did that. And of course, to everybody who watches any of my episodes. Thank you very much. Couldn't have done it without you. And I hope to see you in another series. Don't forget to check out any of the other series, because I try my best in every one of my series, and not only this one. But yeah, the end of a really, really, really long series and an amazing game. I mean, CD Projekt Red, I'm applauding to you guys, because this has been one of the best games I've ever played. Because yeah, I wouldn't have played it for over a year otherwise. So thank you guys enormously for watching the last episode of The Witcher 3 on the that much difficulty. And I hope to see you in another series. So... if you like this video, don't forget to like it right here on YouTube. And see you guys next time. Goodbye.